everyone. Today we're going to do a routine that is entirely out of the Schlossberg method. This is the green book for most people. And it's one of the most classic texts. I think it's like a foundational text for almost everything that we see in other trumpet exercises. The Schlossberg Daily Drills and Technical Studies. It's a gold mine. It's only about 50 pages long, but basically everything you need to be a highly competent player is within these 50-something pages. And it's really incredible. And there are so many ideas that I think are kind of taken from this book and have been transposed in various methods into other ideas and other more modern texts. So we're gonna base out of this because I think it's really a great tool to have a single book you can rely on that just has a lot of stuff in it that you can go to and be like, hey, this is really excellent stuff to have. So before we get into Schlossberg though, I like to do some mouthpiece and some lip buzzing, so we're gonna do that. This will be based out of the stamp method. If you have a piano, that's great. If you don't have a piano to use, you can always use a drone or even a pitch generator on your metronome. Like for instance, even my cheap little Korg tuner here, or my Korg metronome, has a pitch generator. And you could do this by, you can just give yourself a drone this way. You can also use the Richard Schwartz tuning CD or the application that's available for both Android and iOS platforms is called Tonal Energy Tuner. I think it's very inexpensive, maybe $2 or $3, but it's a great tuner and a pitch generator, a drone generator. But we're going to start with the piano since I have the luxury of having a piano in my house. Take this to the mouthpiece and do the same thing, going just for as much purity in the buzz as I possibly can muster. As I've said in other videos, when you're doing lip buzzing, you want to avoid a buzz that's too open. You don't want it to be like, and we also don't want it to be very pinched. You don't want it to sound like. It's a nice blend of those two. You want a resonant and fairly contained buzz that sounds. Same thing with the mouthpiece. I'm gonna move up the scale a little bit more. Often I'll stop right there, but I find once or twice a week, it's beneficial to try to move the mouthpiece buzzing a little bit higher. So that's all I'm going to do in terms of lips and mouthpiece buzzing. Now, we're going to move over into Schlossberg. I'm going to move this microphone just a little bit, my speaking microphone, so that when I turn to say things, it's nice and clear. So now, in Schlossberg, we're going to do, I'll announce these as I go along, but we're going to do a series of long tone exercises that move into long tone flexibilities. And we're not going to do a lot of extreme range things in this. This is a foundation routine that's really based in sound and tone stability. I love to use a metronome for these things, and I like to hold myself true to the metronome. So the first exercise we're going to do is on page one, and it's number two. And we'll do this at 60 beats per minute, and I will hold the fermata for 8 counts. So we're trying to go for immediate purity of sound, and for the crescendo that is just from piano to mezzo forte and back down to be easy, and then when we get back to piano for it to be pure and very pristine in sound with as little air in the sound as possible. These fermatas too, I am subdividing, and I'm trying to think very rhythmically in these. It's very beneficial when you are playing a long note to define what the length is, and then to stay active, keep your mind active in it. So I'm thinking 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 and 7 and 8 and off. And something that I like to do is to keep a tuner on, especially early in practice, to make sure that I am staying in a healthy pitch center. So I put one on in the background that you can see. So something I'm noticing about my playing today is my low register is feeling a little fluffy, a little open. My lips are a little bit puffy from what I did yesterday. So early in my routines, sometimes I find I have to spend extra time getting my low register focused and contained and lifted into a compact place. So I'm going to do a few bends in the middle register and try to take that feeling of compactness from my middle register down to the low register. So I'm feeling much better about my low register now. At the end of the second exercise from Schlossberg, I was not getting a lot of clarity. So what I just did was take my middle register setting, which is very comfortable and easy, and allowed myself to draw it down to the low register. And now moving forward, I will pay extra attention to try to continue that trend of keeping the low register contained and resonant and vibrant. Okay, we're going to move on now to page 2. will do exercise seven. Oh, I'm sorry, exercise six. Do this a little faster at 72. And I will hold the final note of every two bars, which is before the comma. I'll hold that for four counts as like a small fermata. This is just mezzo forte to mezzo piano and back to mezzo forte. And I'm taking a four beat break between these simply for good form, for good health in your shoulders and in my shoulders and my arms to keep my chest relaxed. So my low register is better on this one because I was really engaging with the idea and the knowledge that I was struggling with it before. I do like to extend as many exercises as possible all the way down to low F on whatever trumpet I'm on. So you can do that by extending your third slide really far and your first slide really far. So it looks like this. Really, really far. And then you can play F sharp with 1 and 3, and F 1 and 2 and 3. Mm-hmm. we're going to move to exercise 7. And I know that the exercise, so all of these exercises in Schlossberg, I think editorially, they had to modify some of these things to make everything fit. For instance, in exercise 6, there are some partials missing, but I think it's inferred that you continue down the whole scale and fill in what's missing. And that way they can just fit more exercises in that 50-something pages. Exercise 7, I think editorially there was a mistake, and sometimes the intervals start to go down, but I do believe that the exercise is designed to alternate in a consistent way, and you'll see how that's done. So this I'll do a little bit faster even so. We'll do this at 92. And again, I will hold now 4 counts for the fermata. Conscious when you are moving to the upper partial, notice that it's mezzo forte to pianissimo. So you really want to go dai, very pristine and quiet. So I believe all of these next exercises are supposed to be moving upward. I'm sorry, the opposite, exactly as it shows. Also do that exercise by taking a 2 or 3 count or 2 to 4 count break between each one. For brevity, I'm trying to not do that for this particular video. Now we're going to move to page 3, just the opposite page, and we'll work on exercise 11. I'll do it at the same tempo, and with the same idea, we'll hold for 4 counts. I'm just taking a little break between these two. Have a drink of water. Also going to move this bench out of the way so I don't trip over it. Put it away. same tempo. This is page 3, number 11. And here, this is the first time we're going, and we're moving to an interval and back to our home interval. So, and notice there's no diminuendo or crescendo. So we really want to try to make this as stable as possible. We're going to go dee with no teleporting, no moving between. We're trying to avoid dee. We want dee, much like on a piano. It should sound like. Same, just easy. Mezzo forte, then forte, now piano, and then the last is pianissimo. Mistake should have been 1 and 2. All right, so throughout this exercise, I'm really trying to keep the sound as consistent as possible, and really making the sound as beautiful as I can. A warm and focused sound with lots of vibrancy in it, but without being compressed, and also without having any air, or as little air as I possibly can in it. All right, so now we're going to move to page 4, and we will work on exercise 14. Now, this is expanding our movement. And this does have a crescendo in it. And we're going to go from mezzo forte crescendo to the low harmonic and come back up to a piano. Again, though, we are trying to have smoothness. Even though there's a crescendo, you want the notes to sound like they sort of come from one another. So. For 4 beats. Redo that. So doing these exercises, it's easy to allow your mind to wander. When I made that mistake, I played the wrong line. My mind had wandered a little bit. And I think it's really important to approach exercises whenever you play them, whether they're in a foundation or as a quick warm-up, to really work on it as if it's some sort of performance, as best as possible. You're looking to keep your mind engaged. If you work on your exercises as if there are many performances, it helps to give you more opportunities to feel comfortable performing a thing. Now, that's not to say that you're not going to struggle with exercises or that you're always going to sound incredible, but if you can try to train the tendency of keeping your mind engaged with what you're doing, it will help you to be more engaged when you're playing music with other people. It'll be easier to access that skill rather than watching television and running through your exercises or something. And I know many people can do that very well. I have just found that it helps me more when I'm playing exercises to really try and stay present and in the moment with those exercises. Also, be sure you do take little pauses. I know I'm talking between these, but I would normally take a break, and I might just sit and, you know, twiddle my thumbs or whatever I'm going to do, but it is important to take short breaks between these things. That is a step that a lot of people will miss, and part of going through exercises like this is taking small breaks, just about as much time as you just played, before moving on to the next, and that way you can be maximizing the amount of efficient playing you're doing. Instead of slowly wearing yourself out, you can sort of, you can get a little tired and then have a break and get a little energy back. Okay, now, exercise 15. I'm gonna do this in cut time. Ba, da, dee, da, da, da. Not cut time, I'm sorry. This is just the tempo I'll do it at. Page 6. We'll play exercises 21 and 23. Thank you. pause just for a second and refocus myself. Exercise 23. This starts at piano. There are hairpins, crescendo and diminuendo. I'm only going to go to a mezzo forte. Notice also that the hairpin is in a very specific place. It's not on the high note. It's on the area right after the high note. So it's not da da di da da di da da da. It's da di da 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 di da 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 da. So we're trying to move through the high note, not make it the pinnacle. Exercise 24. So again, the trend in the exercise is to really try to be as smooth as possible, to not let any one note jump out, especially at either end of the range, the high note or the low note. All right, we're going to move over to page 7 now, and we will work on exercise 26. Ba-dee-da-da-dee-da-dee. About these octaves, you notice that in previous exercises I don't always repeat if I make a mistake. If there's a little thing that's not perfect, I try to move through the exercise, not get hung up with repeats. But to me, this is a very critical skill to have in place, is to have a seamless octave. We don't want to have the octave clip or have breaks in it. It should be dong, dee-ah. The note should sound like it continues. See, there was a break, so I'm going to redo that. Really focus on the B flat sounding evenly. To exercise 27. I assume that this should all be played with whatever the open harmonic fingering is. I think it's more beneficial to do it that way as well, because you can really work to keep the sound up and resonant in that partial. Interesting thing to just tag on to the very end of the exercise, right? It doesn't reflect the rest of the exercise at all. You could do that entire thing as its own exercise. Now, we're going to move to exercises 28 and 29. I will do these as a joint exercise. You'll see how I do it. And it's exactly as I demonstrated in one of my exercise of the day videos. I like to combine the two and piggyback exercise 29 onto 28. And some days I'll work on this and I'll try to make it like an orchestral forte at the top with a beautiful vibrato. Today I'm going to challenge myself to play it extremely stably, no vibrato at all, very pure and very full at the top. Myself with a little vibrato creeping in. little unstable throughout. I didn't start quiet enough. It's supposed to start at piano. Challenging exercise to do in that way, because it goes through your entire working range, and getting to the top and sustaining that with a beautiful sound, having a slight pause without a big breath, and continuing into exercise 22 is a distinct challenge. Continuing into exercise 29. Now we'll move on to page 8. Now that we've done some loud playing, we're going to go through 31, which is very slow and very soft. I will do this at the same tempo of 92. I think it's easy to sometimes read a little too much into very slow. I don't think he means to do this at, 48. This is not a grave. The point is to not have it be ba-dee-da, 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 da-dee-da, da-dee-da. It's challenging enough this way. This is another one of those strange places where I think it is inferred. Break in the middle of this. To be very insistent on those octaves being the same. It's a challenging exercise to do, to keep it on your face like that and to have the octave sound beautifully and to have the sound not change as you go up or down. both of those, neither of the octaves were good. Start one more time. I'm really trying to pay attention to keeping the upper octave really resonant and colorful, but without being sharp. And you, if you looked at last time, I was sharp all on all of the upper notes. So, and I could hear that I was sharp. I wasn't even paying attention to the tuner. I could hear that the pitch was high and also it was a little more closed. I want the timbre to stay the same. So much of how you practice high notes and get better at playing high notes is how you hear yourself. I know people who can play the notes C and D and E, and they're there, but they don't sound the same. They don't have the same characteristic as the rest of their range. And I think that if you can work toward having all of your register sound as similar as possible, it enhances your ability to control your sound everywhere, and it enhances your ability to play a variety of music. If whenever you go high, your sound gets contained and small or really, really brilliant, that is a challenge when you are asked to play something very pianissimo and transparent on the high register. So now we're going to continue on page 8. We'll do exercise 31. No, I'm sorry. What have I done? I've made some mistake with my. What did I do? Oh, we just did 31. I'm sorry. I just was reading my notes incorrectly. I do try to make plans for what I'll do on any particular practice session. For this particular day, I wrote down the series of exercises that I wanted to do out of this book. So I try to follow that. And unless I'm experiencing something that series of exercises is not letting me solve, that something that requires me to add a different exercise, I try to stick to the plan. It's important to have the skill of being able to know what will get you what you need to be accomplishing. I think it's very frequent that players will develop and they will be good players and they will just kind of pick and choose as they are going through their practice session what they're going to do. And my experience has been that if I follow that method, it leaves me sometimes forgetting about certain skills or maybe avoiding doing something that's difficult for me. So I force myself to, on a daily basis, look at my practice sessions and say, okay, what is it that I need to do today, both to maintain my skills, to develop my skills? What do I need to do to balance what I did yesterday or earlier today? These are really important things to do. For instance, I made a video a few days ago with a foundation routine, and in the middle of it, I was doing a Clark exercise. I was doing Clark threes, and I was stumbling all over myself finger-wise because I realized in that moment, oh, I haven't done Clarks in that register in weeks. It's like, it's an interesting thing. It's a reminder. Oh, you have to be aware of when you are and are not accomplishing these different tasks. Okay, there was my break too. So now we're going to page 14, exercise 49. These are octave exercises. These are so much fun if you approach them in the right way. The same as I was doing earlier, you know, I was harping on myself to keep the octave sounding the same. Well, now is our opportunity to really focus on that. We want the octaves to sound just like a piano. It should be bouncing, the upper note bounces out of the low note. We don't want to be di-ya, di-ya, di-ya. Da-hi, 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 da-hi. Ah. I was not satisfied with that at all. And if you listen to it again, you'll hear, oh, all the notes were uneven, the upper notes were jumping out, and there were some chips. I'm gonna redo that. It is difficult to do if you maintain the low register fingerings to have that even octave, but I think it makes it especially a large challenge. If you can do an octave, a D octave, with 1 and 3, clearly it will be very easy to do if you go 1 and 3 to 1. So, for instance. Instead of. Well, I'm not demonstrating well, am I? Okay, anyway, I think you get the point. Continuing. Shoulder a little bit. All right, now we're going to continue with exercise 50, which is an extended challenge of this. On this exercise, I will play all correct fingerings. So no carrying the low octave fingerings through. You can practice it both ways, though. It is certainly beneficial. It makes it more challenging to play the low register fingerings up high, the alternate fingerings. So I got a little bit hitched at the end when I went to the low register. As anyone who's watched multiple of my videos know, I have a bit of a hitch, of a break that is in my low register around A flat and G, and I work through that every day. It's something that I have to just hit, like a hammer on a nail head every single day, just continuing to work on it. And I got a little hitched there, so I'm going to redo that. To make it and keep things sort of together. All right, we'll do the same thing in B. Transpose that, and it's funny when you're reading something, you're trying to read and transpose instead of just thinking about the octaves. It's kind of a bit of a brain trick. I was thinking, oh, we'll do B, realizing that the next the next exercise in the book is actually just a totally different pattern entirely, which is what I will do now instead of what just happened. So I'm gonna, instead of doing the whole exercise, I'll back up a little bit. I've tried a few permutations and none of them were working. So now, since I can't get it to work at that tempo, I'm just going to slow it down some. Break register. Great exercise for me to work on a regular basis, these sort of octave displacement exercises. Trying to get myself comfortable with that regular octave now. Something is a little bit tricky in here for me, right? You can hear I'm struggling with accuracy in various ways. I can play a high B, that's not a problem, but there's something in this area. So this is one of the great things about rotating exercises through your routines, is that you come upon something, you're like, oh, this is like a stumbling block for me. This is something I can pay extra attention to and it will enhance my playing. I've tried to find a way to play the octaves well and then slowly make it more difficult, a little more challenging. This is how I expand the exercise to try to make the whole exercise better. So I think what it is for me, it's I get into this low register and I have a tendency of opening somewhere and I get a little stuck in that register. If I start in my middle register, I can do it. If I start in the low register, it tends to be more of a challenge for me, right? I think a lot of people have that issue. So I'm going to work on this just a little bit more and then I'll continue. Thank you. So for me, I'm gonna move past this exercise for now, and it's something that I can revisit now that I know, okay, here's a problem. I had problem transposing the other thing earlier. I was in my head a bit about that. I can add it to my radar for tomorrow or for later, or for the next few days, I'll be like, okay, I will come back and revisit octaves. Maybe I'll have a session where I do 20 minutes of various octave displacement exercises, but I could get stuck working on this one particular thing for 20 minutes. I don't want to do that though. It's also important for me to finish this series of exercises and then be able to move on with my day. So now we're going to finish off over on page 18 with some lip drills. All right, this is 60. Very quiet and very even. Sorry, exercise 60 now. This will be at 90 to. Why I chose to end with this, actually, we've been playing a little over an hour now. Getting to the end of this series and doing pianissimo things that go to the high register, it is challenging your embouchure. For me, I'm tired. My corners are a little bit tired, and I'm having a little trouble keeping the center of the sound focused. So I'm going to do that exercise again. To do the exercise by taking a slight pause between each and re-articulating. A couple of the times I did it, I was challenging myself to not take a break between it. I'm going to move over to exercise 62 on page 19. And this will be the last thing that we do on this video. And we'll do the Yeah, we'll do it as written. Back at 60 again. Come on, metronome. There we go. So this is a little sloppy for me. I'm going to slow it down a bit. Oh, is your little paw hurting you? I'm sorry. My dog, Ollie, and I were out playing disc this morning, some frisbee catching, and he hurt his little paw a little bit, so he's limping. I'm sorry. Your little paw hurts. You want to lay down by my feet? Down. Good boy. Rolling around on the microphone. I'm sure you can hear that. All right. So that's going to complete what I'm doing for this Schlossberg exercise series. The big arc of this is that we spent a lot of time playing long tones and simple connection exercises. This was a routine based very much in sound development and sound consistency. So there were areas where I was very comfortable, and there were a couple things that I ran into in the latter part of the series where I struggled a bit, right? And there are things, so as I said, I'll add those to my to-do list where I will focus a little more on them and just sort of try to address that. But this is an example of one way you can get through a series of exercises. Now, you know, I'll take a couple hour break or about an hour break or so, and I'll come back and I'll work on some repertoire and just have an enjoyable day playing trumpet for the rest of the day. And know that I put some good time into some focused foundation things. Some other things that I will be sure that I touch today will be some articulation, some high register playing, not a whole lot, just some high register focused things, maybe like a Smith top tones scale series, or maybe Clark 5 that goes to the upper register. And I'll want to do some specific loud playing. But outside of that, maybe another 20 minutes worth of work totally, I'll just play some repertoire and have a good day with it. So hope this is helpful to somebody, and I hope you have a great day.